Hey guys, I'm Sean from Plague and choreographer of AIM Collective. So firstly, thank you for having me on this. We're going to speak about a few things. So we're going to cover the history of popping, speak a little bit about where it came from and its relation to the UK scene and how the UK scene is currently too. We're going to cover some foundation steps within the popping style. We're going to also speak about how to use those foundation steps and freestyle with them or create more movement with them. So how to create variations and interpret it in your own way. So popping as we know it wasn't always called popping. It started in the mid to late 1960s in Oakland, which is in the Bay Area of California. Some of its earliest influences were James Brown, if not the biggest influence. James Brown used to dance and perform in his shows, and when he would dance, people would ask him, "What's that dance you're doing?" And he would reply, "It's the boogaloo." So there wasn't any specific moves or set movement for this. But I would say it did have a particular image which started to catch on with the other dancers who were impersonating James Brown at the time. So another one of its earliest influences would be the robot. So there was a lot of mimes and people doing the robot around that time too. I would say the influence of James Brown, the influence of the robot, these things started to form together and slowly create and develop into what we would eventually go on to call popping. So the dancers from Oakland and the Bay Area, they would also start to do talent shows and performances, and a phrase started to get used more often, which was "strut your stuff." Go ahead, do your thing, strut your stuff. They would say stuff like this to each other, and this is how the term strutting started to get coined. So at the earliest, we had boogaloo, we had robot, and we had strutting. So these three components would also go on to shape what we would eventually call popping, which didn't start getting called popping for maybe at least another 10 years. So the term popping became more associated with the Electric Boogaloos, who went on Soul Train in the late 1970s, I think 78 or 79. Somewhere around that time. Soul Train was a popular TV show in America. It had a lot of dancers, a lot of singers. It was just like live performances on TV for the family to watch. So Electric Boogaloos went on TV and performed popping, and it was seen around the world. And that is kind of how popping began as a global phenomenon. So that was the late 1970s. Popping arrived in the UK in the early 1980s. So there were a few people here who were doing their thing. They were doing their own interpretation of what they thought popping was at the time. So one of the earliest moments where popping, you could see that it had really arrived into the UK scene, was the performance of Jeffrey Daniels from the group Shalimar. They're a pop group called Shalimar. And they performed on Top of the Pops in the early 1980s. So Jeffrey Daniels had been in America and he had learned and experienced the dance popping from the Electric Boogaloos and others. So he came back to the UK and performed on Top of the Pops. And during his performance, he did a short dance, which he performed some popping in that. So from that moment onwards, it grew more and more within the UK scene. So for the first year or so of me trying to learn popping, it would be mainly from seeing music videos and trying to imitate what I'd seen in the video, bearing in mind I was teaching myself at this time. Or I would also go onto websites such as electricboogaloos.com or fantasticpoppers.com and a few others. So there were like short clips of people dancing on these websites. there was no YouTube at that time. YouTube hadn't been created yet. So yeah, I would visit those websites and see clips of people getting down, doing their thing. And it really created some excitement for me to see that. There would also be dancers with like double barrel names. So such as Poppin' Pete, his speciality would be popping. There would be another dancer with a name such as, for example, Boogaloo John. His speciality would be Boogaloo. You'd have another example, maybe Scarecrow Sam, you know? So these people had their own special styles of popping, and they would normally have the style before their actual name or their performance name. So that was really interesting for me to see that these styles were almost like superpowers. So this created a lot of excitement for me to see that, and I started trying to work on which one I wanted my superpower to be. So with the arrival of YouTube in 2005, I would say that completely changed the game. So I went from just teaching myself and kind of making it up in my own head to actually having instructionals and tutorials available on YouTube for me to look at and compare what I had been teaching myself with what the teachers from America and the pioneers actually were saying that you should be doing. So I was able to iron out certain things and correct certain things about what I was doing, which was really helpful. And that was in 2005. So I would spend the next few years learning like this. In 2008, that's when teachers had began flying into the UK from America. So pioneers such as Sugar Pop, Poppin' Pete, and so forth, where I began to take their classes and workshops and learn directly from them in 2008. So from 2008 until maybe 2012, 2013, I spent a lot of my time training hard, taking a lot of workshops around Europe, around the world, and learning as much information as I can. So across that period of maybe 5 or 6 years, I was completely focused on learning as much as I can. So from that moment onwards, my journey has just been ongoing and continuously developing. I think I started teaching popping in around about 2012. So I had been teaching prior to that, but it wasn't popping. So I was doing choreography and performances and just general choreography, not really based on any style. So yeah, my journey as a popping teacher began in 2012. Where I started teaching at a studio, and then eventually teaching different crews and companies around the UK, and then eventually outside of the UK, and that's still what I'm doing up until today.
Yeah.